This is a test of the Bounty Park Alert System.
Hello, welcome to the Bounty Park Alert System with me, Matt Dean. I'm a little bit hoarse this morning. I had a gig last night and I've not been too well over the last week, so I'm feeling it a bit. I've also got another gig this afternoon, so it's just as well the podcast is today, not tomorrow, because I don't think I'll be able to speak tomorrow. But I'm feeling good, though. Latic's won. Oh, no, we didn't win yesterday. But Latic feels like a win yesterday because we actually played well. And that, to me, was the most important thing. Andy, you are a little bit rough this morning, are you? Because you said you went to a birthday party last night. Is that?
Yeah, it was my mate's 50th.
Yeah.
Sign of the times, that, and it's not good.
But you had a good one.
Yeah, I had a few pints out in southwest London with a load of rugby bifters watching the egg chasing.
Oh yeah, yeah. So Dave, that's Dave's seen that.
Yeah, a lot of people called Rupert and Sebastian stuff like that.
Well, that's your circles anyway, isn't it? Pretty much not down there. So well, you know, you've just got to enjoy whatever's going on. Our guest this week has been on before. We were just debating whether we should do the three questions because he has done them before, but let's do them quickly.
Yeah, just to see if people can go back and see if you consistently answer the same questions or not. When was your first game returning fan guest?
So my first game was kind of around the early 90s. One of the first I remember, I think it was the guest last week who actually said the same, was when we got beat by Liverpool when Julian Dix scored from about 30 yards out. We lost 3-0, I think it was. I remember my dad being absolutely furious at Richard Jobson at the time.
Yeah, well, furious at Richard Jobson. What would he made of some of the defending yesterday? What is your favourite Latics related? Oh, no, who's your first favourite player, actually?
Gunnar Haller.
Yeah.
Gunnar Haller was the first name that I had on the back of my shirt. So remember the red and white lace, the way?
Yeah.
I had 7 Haller on the back of that. Absolutely loved him.
Yeah. Favourite Latics related memory?
I'd probably say Fulham. Fulham simply because there was no way on this earth were we going to win that game. And we did. So yeah, I'd probably say Fulham.
And give us a little known facts about yourself, an unknown fact about yourself, maybe a different one from last time.
Yeah, I was going to say we had this chat last week, didn't we? Because I previously said about the Dylan Fage question, but it has also come back to me that I played in the same Oldham Sunday League Championship winning side as David Ayres for the Rifle Range Royal Blues in 2010. We had a question and answer evening with him in the pub in around November time. And he agreed to sign and play a game towards the end of the season. And he did. He stuck to his word. And we beat, I think it was Clayton Athletic, 8-0. And he actually scored a free kick in that game as well. I also dragged him off a corner because I used to take the corners and put it straight out for goal kick.
That was a bold move. Right, you might recognise his voice. Who are you?
I'm Paddy Harwood.
Twitter contrarian. Patrick Harwood.
I'm not so sure that's
okay. Welcome back to the podcast.
I think this is your fourth.
I don't know because I've muted you now, so I don't know if you're a Twitter contrarian or not.
I think I've done the same, you know, Matt.
Fair enough. Welcome back. Andy, did you watch the match yesterday?
I did.
Yeah, Paddy, you were there, no doubt.
Yeah.
I think we can all agree that it was a very, very much improved performance yesterday, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It
was a good game of football to watch. I actually enjoyed it. I actually came away thinking, you know what, we shot ourselves in the foot a bit, yeah, with the goals that we conceded. But on the whole, what a difference. I just really enjoyed it. We've got a few interviews lined up. We've got Dave speaking to Mickey Mellon and we've got Liam Hogan from yesterday. But before we have a listen, just Paddy, what were your main takeaways from yesterday's game?
To be honest, first and foremost, I was really disappointed that we didn't win. To be so dominant in the game as I thought we were, because I thought we were excellent, to have been so dominant and not win, despite where they are in the league, was quite disappointing, really. I said to my father-in-law at half-time yesterday, So obviously it was 2-1, and I said the thing that really is concerning me at the moment is we have been streets ahead of them, and we're still only one goal up, and they were never ever going to come out the second half as bad as they were in the first, and the two changes they made did gave them a little bit of momentum. I thought the penalty was harsh, but I was at the other end, and I did think that it seemed very harsh, and you could tell by Kitchen's reaction as well. But my main takeaway, to be honest, and you might feel it's been maybe a little bit negative, but really disappointed that we didn't win when we played as well as we did, because we were excellent. I thought Norwood was unplayable for an hour, 70 minutes, until he did start to tire. But it's a game, really, that on the face of it yesterday, we should have been coming away with 3 points, in my opinion, anyway.
Yeah, I think we threw the points away when we conceded that goal in the first half. I think if we go in 2-0 at half time, we hold out. We might concede in the second half, but we hold out. And it was such a soft goal to give away and so against the run of play. And it's one of them things, isn't it, Andy, where teams at the top just seem to get that little bit of luck or whatever it is. Like you say, when Dobra came on, he hit the bar and, like, you know, it makes a difference. But we totally were the better team overall. And it was the first time, Andy, this season that we actually put like a 90-minute shift in and looked like a good team for 90 minutes.
Yeah, I could have won it towards the end. You know, Dallas had that chance and you know. Yeah, it was loads better. I mean, when I saw their team sheet, I was scratching my head why they got like four of their best players on the bench. that was strange. Maybe they were, you know, looking to win the league at home or resting a couple of players. But you sort of knew when they pulled that goal back just before half time that all they had to do was bring a couple of those players on in the second half and it was just going to go up a gear, wasn't it? So, yeah, we had our best, probably best 11 footballers on the pitch, didn't we, to start with, and they began to tire and you just knew Chesterfield would come into it. So we needed a third goal once that. Whose fault was it for the first one? It looked to me from the stream like Hogan missed his header.
Yeah, I've got Holden down as being at fault as well.
Yeah, so I
haven't seen the goals back. I mean, yesterday, I remember like looking over to talking to my nephew, then looking back up, and it was like they just like cut through us. We looked like, you know, there was, I don't know, I missed it, and you just put the ball into the net really easily, and it was like, oh damn.
Similar happened a couple of minutes earlier, where they had a throw in towards a George Hill stand, and the ball just bounced over Hogan's head. And he got away with that one, and then he did. He missed another header, and they had an overload, didn't they? And they finished it off. But I agree with what you said. I think that goal really did kind of kill us. Really,
you kind of knew it was coming, didn't you? You knew there was no way they weren't going to get another one, so we were going to need three at least.
Yeah.
I mean, the things that were noticeable, and it is absolutely baffling, isn't it, how you can go from the shit show at Aldershot to that in a week, because but two complete. I mean, Paddy, you and I were at Aldershot. They're so different, totally different performances, different teams entirely. But the thing that they did yesterday that they didn't do at Aldershot once is they passed the ball on the floor, and they were passing it through the lines. So the midfielders, you know, Lundstrom, Conlon, Gardner. They were all having a go, passing the ball on the floor. And the thing I noticed actually, the front two were brilliant. We played to Dallas's strengths, getting him in behind, running onto it. That's what he needs. There's glimpses of that older shot, but not enough of it. Instead of long balling it and hoofing it to him when he's got no chance of holding it up. The thing I noticed yesterday was when the ball came into Dallas's feet, it bounces off him a bit, doesn't it? His first touch wasn't great, if I'm honest. Whereas when the ball comes into Norwood, more often than not, he gets it down and then lays it off. But Dallas, it pinged and bounced off him. He needs to work on that a little bit. But when you play it in for him to run onto, then those two should be causing havoc every week with teams that we play. So it's absolutely baffling that the week before we just sat so deep and launched 40-yard balls. It's got to be banned, hasn't it?
Well, we'll have a listen to Mickey Mellon in a second, but I think, I mean, he expressed in his post-match interview his frustration at them not doing what they did yesterday, because he said that that's what he wants from them every week. It's not that he doesn't want that intensity, but what they did really well yesterday was press played higher up the pitch. Like the Chesterfield kept getting caught offside a lot yesterday because our defensive line was further up. Our midfielders were supporting our attackers when depressed. Especially in the first half, Chesterfield were playing the ball out to their defenders. And we were cutting off all the avenues for a pass in midfield. What our off the ball play was really good. We were just cutting off all the angles and pressing them, and the ball was going back to the keeper, and they didn't know what to do with it, and they couldn't play. We stopped them from playing football. And then, like you said, Annie, when we got the ball, we actually kept it and played with confidence, and it came from the midfield. In this interview now, Dave chats to Mickey Mellon, and they talk about the midfield. So we'll play that, and then we can have a little bit of a chat, a bit more about it.
Key OFC podcast. Josh Lundstrom looked like a fantastic new signing today, didn't he? He was covered every blade of grass, didn't he?
Yeah, Josh, young lad, relatively young in terms of, I mean, playing this environment. So we're working hard with Josh to get him to the player that we all know that he can be, but still a work in progress. So really pleased we dipped him out for a wee bit to sort of give him thinking time a wee bit to get himself going. And he went out the other day and showed the qualities that we know that he undoubtedly has. And now it's about him keep moving forward as a player, doing the right things that a good player does. But he's got all the attributes. Delighted he's here. I know what a good player looks like, so I'll keep working with him and helping him and keep pushing him in the right way to try and make him the player that I believe he can be.
He looked a little bit more relaxed today because he had a tendency previous games to go backward with his play, but today he really pushed forward.
Yeah, it's a big deal to play at Oldham. This is what you've got to remember. It can be a big deal to play here for a lot of players. When you've been maybe a god, you respect to some of the clubs that these players have been at, to come here and go boom, takes a settling in period. So to go on with what you want today and be the player that you want to be and also deal with all this can take time. Can take time, but it looks like you're handling it better now. And there's a few like that. There's a few. But that's up to us to use our experience to try and nurture them forward. And he did look a lot more relaxed today, and we'll be encouraging him to remain relaxed and keep playing the football the way he's playing.
And Tom Conlon got a call up to the England seats, fully deserved after a performance like that today.
We love Tom. We love Tom. Even Tom knows what we like, and we're pushing. We wanted more from Tom in the last few weeks. We know the player that Tom can be. Tom can be like that today, dominant, picking up in the seconds and driving us forward and all that kind of stuff, which he did today. So he's another one that we expect a lot of, and today he delivered, so he can be pleased with his performance as well.
And he excited about the partnership with Norwood and Dallas, because that second goal was an absolute class piece of football, and even Dan Gardner rolling back the years, I didn't know he could run that fast.
I thought Dan was great. I thought he was really good. We just felt that his quality, we could get Kitchen forward today by getting Dan Gardner on the ball. Kitchen likes to play with people in front of him. But we don't have any wide players. We have Ethan, so it's difficult for us at times. But we just thought, you know, we'll find a way by the qualities of the players that we have in the group to try and get us up the pitch and run the outsides. And I think Dan Gardner did that great for us, and Kitchen got run the outside countless times. So it goes up the pitch with good quality. In the partnership, I've got a club of four strikers that are tasked with scoring his goals. I don't have any favourites. Their job is to score his goals, and I don't think that the two are the only that are going to score his goals, and I'll change them. And that's the way that we speak about them. We call them the club of four. You four, get us the goals, make us successful. And today they were able to do that. So I was really pleased with them. And Dan was a good finishman, a good run from midfield as well.
It was nice to see Laurel and Hardy have a performance today, and the linesman and the referee, they were shocking, weren't they? How bad were they?
Oh man, it's a shame, because I don't think every bit of contact's a foul. I think there's too many times. I mean, the whistle just keeps getting blown, and does it get any kind of rhythm to the game? And then so many decisions you don't get. And then he said he booked Gartner for two fouls. Centre back had 10.
Yeah.
And didn't get booked.
Yeah.
It's just crazy. It's just madness. But I don't want to talk about them.
No.
I want to talk about my team, and I want to talk about the environment that the fans created today. they were all positive for me. That's what I'm excited about. I can't control them. But what I'm delighted to be a part of today was the fantastic atmosphere created by our brilliant supporters. And my players went toe-to-toe with the champions elect. So that's a big day for Oldham. And we want to build forward and we want more.
And at the end of the season, Mickey, are you going to come on the podcast for half an hour of a chat?
I don't know. Oh. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. But I communicate with the Oldham fans the best way that I can all the time. So I'll continue to try and do that the best way I can.
Thank you very much.
All right, guys.
Right, Mickey Mellon there, non-committal on the podcast question. But it's true, yesterday was what I was hoping for against Kidderminster. You know, the atmosphere, the performance, showing us that they've turned a corner. And like you said before about the chalk and cheese performance from last week to this week, it's not a question that we've been able to answer all season, but Paddy, can you put your finger on what it was about yesterday? Was it that the players found it easier to get up for a game where they considered themselves to be the underdogs, do you think?
It could be, but that's pathetic, really. They should be up for it anyway. You've got 7,000 fans at home backing on. They should be able to turn over the likes of Kidderminster, because for National League, we've got good players. We have got good players for the National League that we're way below where we should be in the table. We shouldn't be clinging on to the playoffs or just trying to sneak in. I think they have got performances like yesterday in them. And I said after the Aldershot game, when they have a horror show, they usually follow it up with a decent performance. But the problem is they've also got a horror show in them. And I don't know if it's a mentality thing. Or I heard him just say then about Lundstrom, about struggling to adapt to play for a club like Oldham. I mean, with the greatest respect, with Oldham Athletic, it's not Galatasaray. He was playing in the same division last season for a club that finished higher than us, didn't they?
Yeah, but I think the expectation that comes with being at a club, you know, like Wrexham, Chesterfield, Notts County, Latics, maybe even Southend, probably is more than Altrincham. It's, you know, Alti getting into the playoffs is a great achievement for them. So the pressure's probably the same. I thought that was quite revealing, that he's giving a little bit of an insight into the psychology that affects some of the players. The other player that came to mind when he said that was Dan Ward to me, because he's not featuring now, is he? And he's come from Gateshead, again, another club where the expectation probably wasn't quite as great. And could he adapt? And probably some of the... He comes back to that recruitment in the summer. When they were recruiting players, maybe on the stats, some of these players looked all right, but maybe they didn't quite understand the mentality of the individual and what it might take to get them to fit into the club and change the culture and all that. I just thought it was quite revealing. The other thing I thought was revealing in that interview was where he said Kitchen likes to play with someone in front of him. Well, that's interesting, isn't it? Because I always thought Kitchen preferred being wide on in a five, but maybe he doesn't. So maybe playing as fullback is something he'd rather do than wingback, because he certainly hasn't been at it at wingback. He was much better yesterday, Kitchen, wasn't he? Much better.
He was, but what doesn't make sense about that is that Gardner and Walker have been available for the last 5 or 6 weeks and haven't been playing.
On the stream commentary yesterday, Roy said that Walker's had a niggly injury for a few weeks, so that might explain why he's not been on the bench.
He's been at every away game that I've been to, warming up as like the 17th, 18th man. He was at, what's the TV, get Ebbs Fleet. He was there, running along there, fine. You wouldn't be taking him if he was injured, surely.
Well, maybe he just had a niggle. He wasn't quite 100%. So if everyone else is fit, he's chosen not to select him.
Gardner's been available.
He has, and that is puzzling, isn't it? You know, the problem with Dan Gardner is he can't play twice a week, can he? That's the issue. So you have to rotate him, because he's made of balsa wood. So, but if they wrap him up in cotton wool, don't train him too hard, just keep him fit and play him once every second game, then he's going to add something at this level, isn't he? Because he played well yesterday. He was very good. You know, so
I'll tell you what, yesterday when the players went off who were substituted, they got standing ovations. And I think that would have been the case for any single one of that starting 11 that went off as the substitutes today, because they all played really, really well. And I think it is a mentality thing that for whatever reason, they've not been able to perform. But yesterday they did, and we've said it a couple of times now, that's the bar, that's the standard that we expect. I think the formation helped. I thought Harrison McGuy had a really good game at fullback. I thought, you know, he filled in that position really well. And
It's another rhomboid in a star shape, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. But he did well, and the shape was better. The 4-4-2, it just worked a lot better. It seemed to me that the midfield was kind of fluid a little bit. They were sort of changing and into sort of like backing each other up and moving around. They were covering for each other. There was a lot more aggression. Conlon was tackling more. Sherin was doing his usual thing. Lundstrom was a lot more effective with the ball, a lot more positive. It's just we've got to back that up now by going, because we can't a draw at home to Chesterfield, you'll take it. Like you said, Paddy, very, very disappointing because we should have won that game. But you say, okay, looking at the grand scheme of things, that's not too bad. We've got to go down to Dagenham now and win. We've got to win these games now. We can't go out to not lose. We've got to go out to win, because otherwise we won't make the playoffs, and we've got to finish strong. So that is that our strongest team then, do you think? Is that the team that we'll play every week if we can, all things being equal?
It's similar to what Andy said, though. There's still a few square pegs there. I mean, McGay did do all right yesterday, but it's a different game when you've got a winger running at him, which, to be fair, Chesterfield didn't really do yesterday. And, you know, I can't imagine Dan Gardner's going to play every game between now and the end of the season. At the moment, the front two are the front two that have got the shirts, but we've seen this before where Norwood and Nuttall are going to be the partnership, or Fondop and Norwood are doing well, or Garner and Norwood, they're going to be the way going forward.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you wouldn't put it past Latic to follow up yesterday with a 3-1 defeat at Dagenham and be just as bad as it was against Aldershot. Yeah. As good as they are at reacting to bad performances, and they've not lost two league games all season in a row, and they should be commended on that, but they do still have a horror show in them. And we won't get them now until the Wellstone game without one.
No, you're absolutely right. If we just look at the fixtures, I've got all the fixtures up for all the teams around us. So we've got seven games left. We've got three at home and four away. Two of those four away are against teams around us in Halifax and Alti. So seven out of our two are teams around us. If you just look at some of the other teams around us, their fixtures, Altrincham have got seven left and two fixtures against teams around them. But they're at home against Gateshead and us. Gateshead have got eight left, but they've got four against teams around them. Chesterfield, Aldershot and Bromley at home, Altrincham away. Aldershot is 7-2. Solihull at home, Gateshead away. Halifax is 8-3. And they've got Latics, Chesterfield, Barnet at home. And Solihull 7-3. Barnet at home, Aldershot away, Bromley away. So you'd say we've just come through the stickiest patch we've had. And you'd look at those fixtures and you say, also bear in mind that Gateshead and Solihull are in the FA Trophy semi-finals. So they'll have one eye on that. So you'd say probably Gateshead and Solihull have got the hardest set of fixtures. And then Halifax. Yeah, Gateshead, Solihull, Halifax. So it's between, you know, us, Alti and Aldershot have got the easiest run in. Those games against, this is the weird thing about what Paddy says. You try to look at them, you're like, well, if we can beat Halifax and Altrincham, we should be a home and hosed. But then, as Paddy's just said, we could lose 4-1 at Dagenham and 1-0 at Oxford. You just don't know, do you? So it's going to go right down to the wire.
We've games that we must win. We've got to beat Halifax and we've got to beat Altrincham. We've got to beat Rochdale, obviously, because, I mean, they're closing the gap a little bit because of we've been dropping points here, there and everywhere the last few weeks. So, you know, I mean, the thing is, though, it's exciting at least. At least we're looking and coming to the end of the season with, you know, it could be something positive at the end of it rather than, can we stay out of the drop zone or whatever it is, or, you know, just playing for nothing. So let's have a listen to Liam Horgan. He chatted with Dave yesterday. Let's see where he's at with it all.
Liam, it's Sexy Dave from the Oldham podcast. How are you doing?
I'm all right. I'm really good. Thank you very much.
Went toe-to-toe today against the champions. I think we give them a right what for, didn't we? We're just a little bit unlucky.
Yeah, and we owed it from the weekend with the Aldershot, and I've just been in the interview there saying that the games did come thick and fast, and it was a performance. We were well below par, and Aldershot did a job on us. So for the travelling fans and all the rest of it that probably thought we were well under where we need to be, we were probably a little bit flat in terms of, you know, the games that we'd have had, and we're not ones for excuses, but that obviously is a telling point that when you go Saturday, Tuesday with a similar squad, it can get quite difficult, and We didn't grind that one out. And that's what Chesterfield have been probably the majority of the season. You know, they weren't excellent today. We knew they weren't excellent. We knew they were gettable. So we tried to get after them and we showed that in the first half. Our football was better. Our decision making and just all round performance was one that put us on the front foot. And obviously they couldn't handle it, couldn't handle Norse, they couldn't handle Andrew Dallas. And we're just frustrated because I think if that was a Chesterfield team at this point, they'd probably see that game out, whether it's 2-0 or 2-1. So we need to fine tune them last little bit, particularly if we're going to get in these, well, we are going to get in these playoffs that, you know, the one game, we need to manage that because if we do get a lead, which we know we've got goals within this team, and today that's probably created more chances than we've seen in a lot of the games that we've had recently. The back door needs to be closed, and albeit I know I'm a bit dubious on both decisions in the build up to the first and in the penalty, but that's again, yeah, they've got players who are game savvy, and he's played Kitch there and won a penalty, and you know we have a similar position down there with Ethan, and he's honest and wants to get his shot off. But you know, some things like that make the difference, and that's made the difference today where they've got back into the game. But like I said, if we'd have had a start that we wanted to have at the start of the season, we could have been talking about going toe to toe with these for the championship. We know we've got that will within our squad, so for us now we've just got to cement ourselves and get back in those playoffs and deliver when the time comes, and we've got enough of them in the group to be able to do that.
Yeah, and it was nice to see Laurel and Hardy reform for the linesman and the referee. They were bad today, weren't they?
Yeah, listen, I'd just rather us just go out 11v11 with no ref. You're probably going to end up with the same amount of decisions, right and wrong. You know,
he was poor though, weren't he?
They just try and pick up on stuff, and obviously I'm going to be against them anyway in terms of what I get. Yeah. But I mean, their captain goes straight through Norwood on the halfway line, no booking, and you know what, players
Garner
like myself
comes on in 2 minutes and gets
a booking. Players like myself, I've got over, you know, I'm double figures this year for little small things. It's just a bit. Listen, there's loads of things, and we can't rely on that. We can't rely on officials. No. We're 2-0 up in the game, and we should see that out, albeit against a team that, you know, score goals, yeah, at will, and we really did think we were going to see that one, and even add to it. To be fair, we had chances even at 2-1,
yeah,
to go and seal it. So all in all, it's probably as good as a win without the 3 points in terms of how I sort of felt within the game, the way that we played and passed, and tried to control areas of the game. And then obviously when we come off at the end, we was well respected by the supporters, which
what did James Norwood say to you at the very death where you took it off his toe? Was he offside?
He thought he was in, but I think he was offside. I didn't see him. Obviously the noise was up, and I just thought Tom Connell had played too much on it, and I just tried to take the weight off it, and it ended up being in my path, and I've tried to square it for Joe Garner. And like I said, those little moments, the goal for teams who were right at the very top, and we just couldn't get it to go in.
We could have, do you know what I mean? They hit the bar, we hit the bar. It could have gone over one or two ways. So really well done today, mate.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the interview. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you now.
Sexy Dave there with the questions. Liam Horgan with the answers. We didn't have quite all the answers, did we, today? That was the thing. I think it was like a glimpse into the future for me today. I think, you know, we've been saying it all season that and we've said it again today that we're not a full complement of players in terms of positions and stuff, but we're a performance like that shows that we're a lot further ahead than we were at the start of the season. We've just not found the consistency and all the little things that turn draws into wins and that kind of thing. But I think looking at that next season, if we don't go up, we've got to win the league next season, surely, with what we've got in the squad.
Well, it depends what, you know, we're talking about ifs, buts and maybes, but I guess it depends what Southend do. If Southend's 10 points hadn't been taken off and we'd be ninth now, they'd be 2 points in front of us. So Southend are no mugs in this division, and they'll have a decent budget with a decent fan base. So I don't know about that. You know, hopefully there'll be three up and then it'll become a bit immaterial. But we're on that journey, aren't we? Should we just talk about the fact very briefly, because there was a minor social media exchanges yesterday about it. The reason that Dave interviewed Liam Hogan is Liam Hogan went over to the North Stand to collect James Norwood's Man of the Match award because James Norwood shot off early. And there was a little bit of a furore about why. The other thing that's probably worth talking about when it's like culture and attitude and stuff like that. Now, I couldn't give a monkey's, but on a personal basis, whether James Norwood can't be bothered turning up for his Man of the Match award or not. If he puts in performances like that every week, then couldn't care less. Don't care if he doesn't celebrate a goal. Don't care if he doesn't smile. In fact, I love him. I think James Knowles was brilliant. I just like the fact his attitude, his gnarly attitude where he walked up to the Chesterfield fans who were obviously giving him stick before he took the penalty. I love all that. But the possibly, dependent on your point of view, you could say you want like a culture where everyone is in it together. And sometimes you just get the feeling that not everyone's in it together, don't you? Do you know what I mean? Like, I'll give you a couple of, for examples, like, Dan Ward changing his Instagram profile picture from a Latix kit back to a Gateshead kit. Dan Gardner going, no, I'm not celebrating my goal against Chesterfield. You're like, you want him to celebrate. There's just little things like that, little signals potentially that tell you that it's not, everyone's not necessarily completely together. That's kind of the feeling you get. And maybe until that comes, then you're going to have these poor performances in amongst good ones, and that's what holds us back at the minute. I don't know what you guys think.
There's the club of four that Mickey Mellon mentioned before about the strikers as well, which is very Alex Reid very much does not fit into five, does not fit into four in that respect, does it? So the writing's very clearly on the wall there. So, you know, and looking at the squad, I mean, Chesterfield squad are 20 on the back of the programme yesterday, and ours was 32 or whatever it is. There's still a lot of changes that are going to be required. We spoke to John Sheridan yesterday, and we'll play a little clip for in a second or two, but just talking about how difficult it is to get the squad right. You know, we've not got it right over the last two seasons. We've started from scratch. We've replaced players that haven't with players who haven't sort of hit the ground running or you know, delivered what we hoped they would. But I'm quietly confident that it's all coming together now. And Mickey Mellon is not the future of Oldham Athletic, Paddy. Discuss.
He wins football matches. He certainly is. He was the standout candidate. And to be honest, we could only dream of where we'd be if we'd have had him from the start of the season instead of wasting 9 games on your mate.
Yeah. Well, that was all down to the board's decision, isn't it? You know, it's nothing to do with me. So, you know, I've always said, whoever's the manager of Oldham, I'm going to back them. And I hope that they do well. And, you know, we spoke to Shez yesterday. We talked about honesty. We talked about, you know, the way that fans connected with him because of his demeanour. He was as sick as we were when we lost. He was as delighted when we won or we got one over on someone. And when Mellon is in being interviewed, I think he comes across in the same way, and I like that about him. He's very measured. He doesn't get ahead of himself, and he's honest. He's disgusted last week with the performance, and you know, he's doing what he needs to do. You have to trust him to handle players. If he's excluding Alex Reid from that, then he's doing it for the reasons that he thinks are the right ones. And hopefully next season we'll make the appropriate trims to the squad and the key positions that need filling. And I'm confident about next season. I know we shouldn't be ruling out this season, but like we've already said, Paddy, we don't know if next week we're going to go and improve on yesterday's performance or we're going to go back to Aldershot. It's just we have to wait and see.
Definitely. I mean, touching on what Andy said before about the Norwood and the man of the match, I'm very kind of similar that I couldn't give a monkeys if he went over or didn't, as long as he plays like he did. You've also got to bear in mind, he's probably not very happy because he's had to play with Mike Fondop for a lot of the time this season. You know, the guy's come from playing at Wembley in May to having Mike Fondop doing his stupid run next to him and getting his name sang. I think we'll be fine next season. I think there's a few players that they need to move out. And we need to, like I sent it to Andy last night. I know you've just mentioned it there, Matt, about the squad list on the back of the programme. We need to trim it down. It needs to be more quality based. If we're not going to have this B team that was the initial plan, then we need to trim the squad down, you know, and get more quality in, more James Norwoods in, less Mike Fondops in, to be honest.
I think yesterday, what we saw from Norwood, and let's be honest, Norwood's performance yesterday was so much ahead of his performances in the last couple of games. What you saw there was a footballer who wants to be playing in front of big crowds in big games against, you know, good opposition and be testing himself. And he raised his game. And I think that that's the difference between football teams that and clubs that are successful is they get themselves up for Ebbsfleet, Kidderminster, Woking, Real Madrid in the quarterfinals of this Champions League, whatever it is, you go in with the same mindset, the same mentality, the same level of performance. And I don't think that our team has managed to do that this season. And I think Norwood, I think that's what he wants. He wants those games. He doesn't, you know, necessarily, I might be wrong. I'm just basing it on how he looked yesterday, the hunger in him, his work rate, he chased everything down. He just wanted to be involved in everything. He was so annoyed with his teammates when things didn't go right, when he didn't get the ball and he wanted it, even if he wasn't, even if the player that didn't give him the ball did the right thing. He was hungry for it yesterday. And that's what we need to see out of him, you know, every single week. And the same for all the other players. And I think we've called it a lot. I mean, obviously, you mentioned there about David Unsworth and the performances. A lot of it has been on the players because they haven't delivered what they're capable of delivering week in, week out. And yesterday, they've showed us now. That midfield yesterday was head and shoulders in terms of their performance from anything they've done. And it helped the strikers because we were winning the ball further up the pitch and being able to start playing further up the pitch instead of lumping it. And it was actually good to watch. So, I mean, I'm not going to lie, earlier on in the week, I was dreading today, absolutely dreading. I thought we were going to get hammered. And we didn't. We were a better team and we were unlucky not to win. So this club of ours, you just don't know what you're going to get, do you?
Yes, completely frustrating, isn't it? Completely frustrating. Yeah, it is mental. Yeah. You sort of look around. You see what's happening at Reading. The owner's going to sell their training ground to Wickham this week, or trying to sell it. He'll likely run off with the money, and Reading will never see it again. You've got all sorts of nonsense going on at clubs, and we don't have any of that. And I keep tempering my sort of frustration at us not being where we want us to be now with a little bit of, well, you know, there, but for the grace of God, you know, we're in a good place and we just got to be a bit patient. And if it comes this season, amazing. I had a little look. Do you know, I'm getting ahead of myself a bit here again, but what do you think we'll do a mini quiz in the middle of the pod. What do you reckon the largest attendance there has been at a National League playoff final? Paddy?
Go on, Paddy. You're good at quizzes, Paddy.
Not so. I can't remember. You get likes of Salford in there. I reckon about 16,000, 17,000.
Well, there's been a few down there.
Yeah, I reckon. Was it about more like 50,000?
Well, let me give you this little stat. I assumed that last season's playoff final might have been up there because it was between Notts County and Chesterfield.
Right? Yeah.
So two proper Football League clubs, in theory, with proper fan bases. And Chesterfield had given it the big in yesterday about how massive they are. Well, that had 38,138 at it, which actually is quite low. There have been four games that have got more than that. The highest is Bristol Rovers against Grimsby in 2015 with 47,000. Pretty good, isn't it? You think to yourself, what would, two proper clubs, yeah. What would we take? 25? 20?
I don't think we'd take much more than we actually get, you know, at home. I think we'd probably take 15 at the most.
You reckon?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought that probably because of where we're at, I reckon 20 would be our maximum at the minute. People go along for the day out, don't they? People's friends and family come along and all that. And people from Oldham who aren't necessarily Oldham fans, but, you know, it's a trip. So you do get a lot of that. But I think obviously the further up the divisions you go and you're in the League Two, the League One and all that, it always grows, doesn't it? So
there should be a criteria that you've been to at least four games this season and you know the names of the manager at Maidenhead, Wealdstone, Borehamwood, Bromwell. Because the one thing I couldn't stand that Kidderminster game, I hate it when people just join the bandwagon. In some respects, the Lensingham days were the best when there were only 3,000.
Oh my God! Showing your true colours now, buddy.
You see, and as if you wanted to prove your contrarian nature, this is exactly the point that drives it home perfectly. Now you've got to want more people through the gate, and yeah, I know like some of the day trippers can be a bit funny at times. But I mean, if you think about when we played Liverpool away. We took about 6,000 there that day, and all those day trippers out that day as well. But it's great when there's a massive following. I think in the Littlewoods Cup final, we took between 25 and 30,000. And against United, we took between 20 and 25 in the semi-final at Wembley. I'd hope we could get 20,000 in there.
You have to remember is like there are a lot of Oldham fans around the country, around the world, and things that, you know, that. There's a lot of us. There is a lot of us. And not everybody goes to every game. But, I mean, the worst case scenario is when you get to Wembley, you end up against one of these tin pot teams that can't muster 5,000 between them. And you're just rattling around. And, you know, there might be 20,000 of us and there's 5,000 of them. And in Wembley, there's 25,000 people in Wembley. It looks absolutely empty. But, look, I mean... It's just where you're at in the league, you know. Obviously, the more you go up the divisions, the more fans there's going to be. But just to get there would be like incredible because I've still never been.
What you've just said there, Matt, about the crowd though is very likely based on the other teams in the playoffs.
Exactly.
Really.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, and all because that. Yeah, like unless you're playing as like a South End or so, and South End could still scrape in there, couldn't they?
I'd say it probably looks a little bit difficult for them to get in there now. South End have got around 51 points. They're 8 points behind us with seven games left. It's quite a way to make up, probably.
An epic end, but there's a few. There's only a few teams that are likely to take a good following. So, but that, I mean, at the end of the day, that's all just kind of aesthetics and, you know, experience. At the end of the day, it's all about going there and winning. And who cares if there's only 5,000 Solihull fans there or whatever, or Aston Villa fans or whatever they are that are down there for their trip to Wembley. Like, we've got to do it. And having the biggest fan base and having it means nothing. It's all, you know, it's one game. So you'd like to think it would make a difference, but again, we've had this stage fright from these players this season. So I'm not convinced we can go to Wembley and do it. But they did at least prove their credentials for a big game yesterday, and that's something to build on.
Speaking of the playoffs, I've just seen that Halifax are two up, aren't they?
They're playing today, are they?
They're away at Oxford. Yeah, two up.
You know, which is quite encouraging in itself because they've only scored two against Oxford City, who are Bobbins. So we have to go there, don't we? Last away game of the season.
Yeah.
So we could do with boosting our goal difference as well, depending on where we're at by then.
Yeah, I mean, Halifax have got those five games at home that we just said, and they've got Chesterfield in the week. But
them having five home games is not necessarily a good thing for them on that pitch, is it? It's absolutely awful.
No, I mean, while I've got Paddy on here with his contrarian views, we've had this conversation a couple of times. Admittedly, I'm not at Boundary Park every week to see it, but I think our pitch looks fantastic for this time in the season, given that there's been half a dozen rugby games on it already as well.
Three then.
I think the thing is with this pitch, Andy, is although it's brand new, it takes time for it to bed in and become, you know, like for the seed and all that. So I think this season, it's its first season. And I think it's going to get better as like within, and it's going to take a few years to really sort of bed in as and get up to the quality that it's going to. So I thought yesterday it looked better than it did the last time we played. I thought it had some grass had grown on it and it looked a bit better.
How, do you know, you just said about it bedding in. When's it going to bed in? Because the rugby play over the summer, don't they?
Yeah, I know that. I did think that because they play it up through their season ends in September, don't it? So they literally will play it. But presumably they'll only play on it once every 2 weeks or so. So it should get plenty of rest.
You're gonna get a lot of sun, aren't you, in the summer? So even though it's being played on, it grows at a much faster rate and repairs better than it does in the winter months. So hopefully that, you know, there's only the rugby being played.
It will get some sun, Andy. I don't know about lots. Remember, you might get lots down there, but up here, You know, we are limited. But I mean, yeah, you know, you're right, Paddy. It's that it's obviously not going to get a proper rest, but hopefully it's going to get enough of a rest.
But if you compare, I mean, the point I was making, if you compare it to the cabbage patch at Halifax, and I don't know if you've seen Bradford's pitch, it's just it looks like ours did when we were in the Premier League days. It's just sand.
Yeah.
I think it's holding up pretty well, if I'm honest.
The council haven't just spent £1 million on it, though, have they?
Yeah, but that's the thing, Paddy. It will get better. It's not just, it's not sort of at its peak now. I think that's the point. So we'll see.
The one to compare it to is York. York's exactly the same kind of pitch, isn't it? And it's the same purpose. And York's looked immaculate the other week when we were there.
And how long has that been down? Is that two or three seasons with York?
It's definitely been down the two seasons we've played them. I don't know prior to that.
Yeah. So hopefully by next season ours will look like that.
Just need some footballers to go on it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but you know, yesterday let's stay on the positives. They rediscovered passing on the ground, and it made a big difference. And the atmosphere was like, you know, they mentioned it. Mickey Mellon mentioned it there, and you know, we've been talking about it on the phone and on the podcast. It is a two-way thing. Like it. I did notice yesterday, Paddy, that the atmosphere when their goal went in, it did dip. It was like there was this feel of like, oh no, and in the second half it got back going again because of the competitive nature of the game and the way we played. But it was markedly different, the atmosphere yesterday. It felt like a proper football match yesterday. It was great.
Yeah, I think to be fair though. A lot of it does come from the players and how they start the game. It gets people up for it. And we started really well. There's been a lot of games where we've started shockingly. And it's hard to get motivated. And I know they do the best, the Atleticos, but it's very difficult at times when you're losing at home to Kidderminster Harriers to get motivated to be singing songs and
not creating chances as well, isn't it? Like yesterday, there was lots of chances created, near misses. It gets everyone fired up, big tackles, all that kind of thing that gets the crowd going. So, I mean, it completely is on the players as well. It's a joint thing. It is hard to get up for crap football. There's no doubt about that. And we've had plenty of crap football. Should we just have a quick listen to Shez?
Yeah.
Me and Dave enjoy talking to each other so much and occasionally talking about football that we've convinced Oldham Community Radio to give us a show on a Saturday morning called A Look at Latics. And it's good because we get to play a bit of music and just have a bit of a mess about it. It's not so serious. And we managed to get John Sheridan on the phone yesterday. So we had an interview with him in the final third of the show. If you want to listen to the full thing, you can go onto Mixcloud and search for Oldham Community Radio or Look at Latics, and we're on there. But this is just a clip from that interview with Shez talking about his time at Latics.
I come to Oldham when, obviously, Andy, a big mate of mine, when I played with Andy, his manager, I come and I've had lots of problems with my knee. But I come and, I enjoyed it from day one. I was an old, experienced player. He had some good, really good, promising young players at Oldham when I come there, Billy Ames, a big mate of mine as well. And I just loved it. I loved it to bits. I didn't train too much. I just played. Obviously, my experience got me through a lot of games. Obviously, with my knee, I couldn't do it anyway. But from day one, I just loved it. Really loved it. I loved the people involved in the club, the supporters. They're just my kind of people. And when I used to play against them for Wednesday and Leeds, I used to hate playing against them. It was always a really hard place to come. Players in the Milligan and your Henneys, I used to hate playing. I could never get a kick of the ball against them. Obviously, Joe was doing really well with the team. But other than that, managing everything, everyone's always been really, really friendly to me, even though I haven't won anything or done anything there as a player or as a manager. It's been close, obviously, with the players. But I've always felt really close to them. They've never got on me back, ever. And I've always felt support from them. And I was just hoping and trying to, you know, to achieve, whether it's staying out of relegation or getting them out of the league when we were very close years ago. But I've got an affection with them. I'm just probably obviously managing and playing for them, but I think the supporters here probably a lot of me in themselves.
What a guy. He sounded very relaxed today. He's been spending time in Spain. He's got a gaff down there and just life away from football, just relaxing. But it's, you know, it feels like we've been few and far between, Paddy, when it comes to people to really idolise at Oldham from a players and managers point of view. It's been a long time, hasn't it? You know, I think the last manager that you really loved was probably Keith Curl. It's going back a while now.
Don't mention that guy's name. It's still just
but it's what we need, though, isn't it? We need those people to stick around at the club. People like, you know, Mellon, hopefully, will be that guy that stays at the club and we can get behind him. Players like Norwood and Dallas and Conlon now, and, you know, Liam Hogan, who has turned his form around this season, didn't start off great, but, you know, he's now become a real leader. You know, you've got two young boys, Paddy. Do they have any names on the back of the shirts? Like, who are their idols?
Yeah, so my youngest, Bobby, he's got Norwood on the back of his. He had Dan Gardner last season. To be fair, they've had a new favourite player every season because invariably the favourite player leaves.
Yeah,
when Alfie was first getting into it, it was Callum Lang, then Jose Baxter, Everson, you know, those kind of players. At the moment they absolutely love Norwood. They went through a stage last season when Magnus Norman saved about 3 penalties.
Yeah,
and like, he was the best keeper in the world. I soon knocked that out of him.
Yeah, Matthew Hudson's the best keeper at Latics, that's for sure. I don't know about the best keeper in the world, but he's had a good season, hasn't he?
He's done all right. I still think we need an upgrade, you know, if we're going to be serious next season.
Well,
I don't think it's the position that needs sorting out as a priority. I think there's plenty more priorities in front of it. I think he'll do. He's good enough.
A goalkeeper is a massive priority.
Well, he doesn't make many cock ups, does he? You know, he's pretty good. He's pretty good in the air. He catches a lot that comes into the box.
There's quite a few goals go in that he could do better with.
Possibly. But, you know, you could say that about a lot of keepers. I think at this level, he's all right, definitely.
And you'll always say, well, you know, it's down to the midfield attack and defence, but not in that order necessarily, to stop the ball getting to the keeper in the first place. So I think we've looked a lot more comfortable that having a regular goalkeeper and regular defenders. But,
I'll tell you what I did think. Hudson's distribution yesterday was excellent. He picked out players, like, you know, found them. You know, it wasn't all completely punts forward and just hoping that someone would get on it. He would pick players out. So his distribution's pretty good. He can kick with both feet as well. I think he's a pretty good keeper, I'm honest. I'm tackling Paddy on that. Contrary Paddy.
No, he's done all right recently, but I do think we need an upgrade.
Well, let's see, speaking of upgrades, if you did very, very well on Latics Mind last season, Paddy. You were the first guest on that season, weren't you? And set the bar. Nobody beat you through the season on the podcast. So, so you've set a high bar for yourself.
Well, eight is the number. I think you got 7 last year, Paddy. Eight is the number to get this year. That's what Paul Prendergast set on the opening game as well.
Right, well.
And you found the hardest questions as well, aren't you? I know exactly what you're like, Andy.
They have come out of the Paul Prendergast computer as they ordinarily do in a random order.
Please, Paddy, do not question Andy's integrity when it comes to Latics. For goodness sakes. Right, good luck, Paddy.
Thank you.
Who wore the number 7 shirt in 2015-16?
Croft.
Correct. How many cup goals did Latics score in 89-90?
24.
40. Who scored Latics' goal in a 4-1 home defeat versus Gillingham in April 1999?
Paul Beavers.
Correct. Which goalkeeper did Latics sign in September 1996?
Gary Kelly.
Correct. Which non-league team did Latics beat on penalties in an FA Cup replay in 2002-2003?
Burton.
Correct. Which squad number or whose squad number was number 9 in 1999-2000?
Tipton.
Correct. Who did Latics beat 6-1 in December 1990, their biggest win that season?
Brighton.
Correct. Latics legend Andy Gorham spent a short spell back on loan at the end of 01-02 season. Against whom was his only clean sheet against?
Huddersfield.
Correct. Who scored Latics' goal in a 4-1 defeat at Plymouth Argyle in December 2017?
Gerrard.
Correct. Which winger did Latics sign from Barnsley in 2004?
Pass.
Who was in goal for that Mark Hughes goal?
Holworth.
Correct. Which Scottish Premier League side did former Latics players Neil Poynton and Darren Beckford team up at after Latics? Correct. Which future Latics defender, midfielder, gave away the penalty which decided the epic... I've started, so I'll finish. Decided the epic fifth round FA Cup tie versus Everton in 1990?
MacDonald.
Correct. Right, give me 5 minutes while I add these up. 1, 2, 3.
Never kissed a girl in my life.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Is that 11?
I think he got 11, did he?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 11 correct and one pass.
Wow.
Right, you pass. Which winger did Latics sign from Barnsley in 2004? Matt?
I've absolutely no idea, mate.
Paddy?
I can't think, mate.
Kevin Betsy?
Oh, of course he did, yeah.
Can you just prove that you're not, you haven't got an Ethernet cable plugged into your arse or something there, Paddy?
I'm just a loser, honestly. I never kissed a girl in the night.
Right, can you just... How do you is it that you have a genuine memory of that occasion? Is that what it is, or have you been like? Do you just like read like news cron reports
with stuff like Latics? I kind of read or watch something once or twice, and it sticks in my mind.
Right,
it's just a strange. I mean, like Alfie and Bobby, if they're kind of following the same path, they can. Recall the squad list from the last three seasons, you know, with all the squad numbers. Yeah. You said it was number 14 last season, they'd be able to tell you. It, to be honest, if I was at school now, I would probably be diagnosed autistic.
Well, you've definitely got a skill for sure.
I mean, it's definitely basically useless, but it's still a skill. You know, but look, that's incredible, honestly. Like 11 out of what, 13 questions was it, or 14 questions?
Well, he only got one wrong and one pass.
So
13 questions. Yeah, so that is a Latics Mind 4 year, or how long we doing Latics Mind for? 2 years now. Two year record. That is a record. We've never had a score that big. So Paul Prendergast has been knocked off the top. So it looks like the final at Trophy Chest. Oof. He's going to be played out with definitely Paul and Paddy involved again, because they were involved last year.
I had to join online, didn't I? I was at christening.
Yeah,
it's the ultimate Latics. Who is the ultimate Latics Mind? There is it's a two horse race, isn't it? But yeah, very well done, Paddy. That's an excellent score. Any other business, Andrew?
No, that'll do for now. Well, I mean, the only other thing I noted down, actually, but we can probably talk about it in a bit more detail another week because it's a slightly longer topic, is did you see the Premier League failed to vote this week on an improved terms for the Football League?
Yeah.
There were 10 teams. I think apparently the Premier League rules state you've got to get 14 teams to agree to something out of the 20, and 10 didn't agree to move to a motion to vote on improved terms. Of that 10, you can pretty much guess the standard big six, you know, all looking after their own interests. I did find it interesting when I saw Bournemouth in the list of 10. I'm sure I put a pound in their bucket once.
Numerous times.
Yeah.
I think I went there 3 years in a row, and every time they had the buckets out, and I think they'd been saved in between.
Yeah, yeah, it's incredible. But yeah, it's probably a topic for another day, because it comes back to a regulator being appointed. I read an article, which is, again, we won't go through it now, but I think the regulators they're trying to find somebody to lead that independent regulator. I think they found this super lawyer who's been involved in football regulation in the past, who might come in and bang some heads together. So hopefully that'll sort stuff out. But I mean, for us, this just highlights the need to get back in the Football League ASAP, don't it? Because as that money trickles down, we're going to see none of it next season if we stay in National League.
Mm. Well, lads, you proved you could play. So now you need to do it home and away. Thanks for listening to the podcast. Thanks for joining us, lads. Congratulations on your epic Latics Mind score, but I'm not going to unmute you on Twitter. Thanks for joining us. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to the Boundary Park Alert System, a QPod production hosted and produced weekly by Matt Dean, Andy Halliwell and Dave Bradley. QPod is Oldham's only dedicated podcast production company, and if you'd like to learn more about how podcasting can help take your brand to the next level, visit kupod.co.uk. A huge thank you goes to all those people who subscribe to the podcast on Spotify. We really appreciate you all. Please visit oafcpodcast.co.uk and click Be a Supporter, or find the link in the show notes if you'd like to help us fund the show. It's only $2.99 per month to subscribe, but if you'd rather make a one-off donation, please visit buymeacoffee.com/OAFC podcast or click the link on our website. Don't miss the Latics Football Phone-In every Wednesday live from 8:30 p.m. Please visit youtube.com/@OAFC podcast and do hit subscribe while you are there. You can also follow and interact with us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram and TikTok at OAFC podcast. Big thanks go to Eileen Finnegan for writing our excellent weekly blog, which we encourage you to read on our website every Saturday morning, and also to Paul Prendergast for providing us with all the Latics Mind questions. The title music for the show is by Manchester DJ and producer Starion, and for more information visit bandcamp.com/Red Laser Records. If you'd like to be a guest or contribute to the show, we would love to hear from you. Until then, see you next time.